The great historian and educator, Carter C. Woodson, he said this, "I am ready to act if I can find brave men and women to help me." Well, this evening we honor men and women who answer the call to action. It's activists, after all, who make history. We saw that in Montgomery, Alabama in 1955-56, when Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on the bus to a white man. She was arrested and sent to jail. But Rosa Parks' defiance of an unjust law, her act of nonviolent resistance, sparked the Montgomery bus boycott and what some historians now call the Second American Revolution. E.D. Nixon, the president of the local chapter of the NAACP, had laid the groundwork for collective action in Montgomery. And Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., a young minister new to Montgomery, was asked to lead the boycott. Right beside him was the Reverend Dr. Ralph Abernathy. Juanita Abernathy, Dr. Abernathy's widow, remembers the boycott like it was yesterday.
The bus drivers had been so mean to the riders, and most of them were black women. And so when Rosa decided not to give up her seat, that sparked the movement because, see, E.D. Nixon was president of the NAACP. That was the only organization we had at that time. And Rosa was the secretary. And my husband had just closed the membership drive, which he chaired. So when E.D. Nixon called Ralph and said, "Rosa has been arrested, we got to do something. I'm going out of town on my run, so will you call the ministers and tell them we're staying off the buses on Monday in protest of Rosa's arrest?" Just one day. It was not for two or three days. The idea was just one day to let the bus company know that we were upset and we weren't going to take it. And when the buses rolled Monday, empty. And of course the police said, "We will have police protection for any riders who want to ride, and the Negroes are there to stop them." There was nobody there to stop them. People decided, "Oh wow, we're just not riding the buses." Monday they didn't ride. They said, "Okay," we had a meeting Monday night, what they call a pep rally. Said, "Okay, we're gonna boycott Tuesday." Tuesday they didn't ride, and they said, "Well, we're going to keep it going for a week." And it just kept going. Every Monday night they had a mass meeting. And it went on for 381 days and said, "We're going to wait until we change the law. When the laws are changed and we can ride anywhere we want to on the buses, and without any fear of being jailed or anything, then we'll stop." And we kept walking. Through the rain, through the snow, and it snowed in Montgomery, and through the sleet and the hail. We had a whole winter that was horrible. Do you know nobody rode those buses? And the white women who had maids, they had to come and pick them up. And they were happy when everything stopped, because they didn't want to have to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, go pick up the maid to come cook their children's breakfast and clean up the house. So they were livid. They wanted something to happen. And after 380 days, they were free. And do you know that freed America? People don't realize it, but the same kind of thing that was happening in Montgomery was happening all over the North. The blacks had a section. They just had more seats than we had in Montgomery. But in Chicago and Cleveland and New York, they were segregated and didn't even realize they were segregated until the law changed everything. And they realized, that freed us too. And then they had hotel accommodations, public accommodations, period. So they realized that can't keep us out of the hotels. Everything changed. And it started with Montgomery, Alabama. And that's why I say Montgomery saved America from herself.
381 days. Changing your daily life for 381 consecutive days because of something you care so deeply about. It's more important than personal discomfort. It's more important than the normal schedule. It's because you believe deeply. And that is how history is made.
I want you to go back in your mind to 1965, and I want you to focus on the experience of the march from Selma to Montgomery. You can be old, you can have a disability. I just want, from your perspective, you to imagine what that experience was like for them. You gotta get from Selma to Montgomery. It goes beyond simply students reading about a march. It goes beyond their having seen Eyes on the Prize and having taken a quiz on it or whatever. Now it becomes real. And I want them to be active participants in what they're learning.
As I stood proudly on the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, I realized how big this really is. Thousands of people, elderly and young like myself, were gathered here to stand up and fight. We may be Black, African American, Negro, or whatever else they may call us, but there is one word that we are by right, and that is citizen.
It promotes an atmosphere of racial profiling against Latinos because nobody's going to be looking for any illegal Canadians. The discrimination gets more subtle. And anywhere you see it, you have to stamp it out. I believe Dr. King said, a threat to justice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So we got to fight against all forms of discrimination, no matter what form it is or where it is.
You know, when they marched in 1965, it was really about voting rights, the rights to make sure that African Americans had their right to vote. Then it was the poll tax. So today, the voter ID laws, when we look at the fact that 11 million Americans who don't have government-issued ID, and they tend to be people of color and poor people, it's a cost. So this is the new poll tax, and quite frankly, it's the new Jim Crow.
And the AFT has been a partner in calling this from day one, because voter suppression is anti-democratic. The worst immigration laws in the country are here. So for labor and civil rights of the 21st century, those of us on the ground and on the field today are together like they were 47 years ago.
I think it's important to be organized in what is immigration rights, what is women's rights, what is social justice. It matters to labor. It matters to white-collar workers, blue-collar workers, doesn't matter what collar you have on. It matters, and you should be a member, and you should pay your COPE dues, and because it's a really important year, and I think that there's a lot of progress that can be made.
Are we ready to march?
Yeah!
Are we ready to march?
Yeah!
Are we ready to march?
Yeah!
All right, let's march!
I'm gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more.
We did not just come to remember what happened 47 years ago. We came to deal with what is happening in the United States today. But they forget they didn't give us our rights. We fought to get our rights. We suffered, we died, we went to jail to get our rights.
Families living in fear, afraid to have their children go to school, afraid to walk or drive on the streets or roads of Alabama, afraid to live a normal life.
We come here to Alabama, to the most extremist state in the nation when it comes to immigration, to say enough is enough.
Black and brown, red and white, we are here to say no longer will we be silent.
Everybody in, nobody out. Democracy is the path to citizenship, not deportation.
So no, my Latin brothers, no, my Jamaican sisters, no, you do not have to leave. You have to stand with me and fight.
I must tell you that students from ASU joined that fight today with that same passion as people 50 years ago. The ASU students, are you ready to fight? In the 1960s, while we were marching, we elected leaders who fought for programs to make sure those who were oppressed had a level playing field. Programs that helped Black and Latino students get a decent public education, attend college in record numbers, and put kids on the path to the American dream. Today, those educational opportunities are being stripped by the budget cuts that we are seeing in school after school in Alabama and around the country. Are you ready to fight?
A celebration of the past. It's a continuation of right now. You can't dedicate a statue to Dr. King in Washington and then go to 31 states and revoke the voting rights bill he put on the books. We are not going to allow you to steal this election in advance. Our fathers beat Jim Crow. We're going to beat James Crow Jr.
I'm hoping that we expose discrimination and discriminatory practices that are going on that people may or may not know about and help bring it into public knowledge.